I forgot the introduction of guests. Do we have any guests today? I forgot that. So if you all stand for the call to worship, please. God breathed life into human beings, made in God's image.
We remember, so blessed is God, Lord.
God called to a runaway shepherd, Moses, to lead God's people out of slavery.
We remember, so blessed is God, Lord.
God, like a pillar of clouds, led the people through the sea to freedom.
We remember, so blessed is God, Lord.
God caused a rock in the wilderness to flow like a river.
We remember, so blessed is God, Lord.
God gives us a way when there seems no way.
We remember, so worship today.
As we stand together before God, let's join in our unison prayer. O turn our faces, our voices, and our lives toward you, so we might know goodness, receive what we most need, and share the gifts of life with others. Amen.
Joy in the presence of the Lord is in.
The peace and the love of God be with you all.
And also with you.
Turn and welcome one another and leave your pews and say hello to somebody. Let the children come. I'm right. Morning. You'll go up to the microphone when you do it. I'll tell them you're going to do it when I tell you to. Okay, Ray is going to read to us the idea that the kids are working with. Right now, this is what we're working on and learning about Joshua, too.
This year, we are going to present to you the key idea of our lessons. Today's key idea is I study the Bible to know God and His truth and to find direction for my daily life.
Okay. Now, remember the last couple of weeks, we talked about finding direction, and what do we talk about? Signs, right? And then we talked about what? What was last week? The old man can't remember. Let me see that. Okay. Yeah, find direction from God. And then we talked about knowing God last week. And now today, this is what I remember. We're going to talk about knowing God's truth. This is what you're working on in Sunday school. But what is it to know truth? What is it to know truth? Some of you big kids got an idea? When you say something is the truth, what is it?
Yes.
It's real. Yeah. Truth is real. Truth is what actually happened. Truth is what is obviously nothing wrong about it or false about it. That's what truth is. And the problem we have sometimes with everybody is, I bet if all of you were to see something happen right in front of you, everybody would have their own truth, because everybody sees things differently. It's not that some people, when they talk and they say it different than what you saw something, it's not that they're liars always. Sometimes it's the way people see things are just differently. But there is God's truth that we learn in the Bible, just like we learn how to go different places of where we need to go, like we learn how to know who God is. We learn God's truth too. And God has a truth that is the truth, the real truth. And the way God sees things is right, always right. So that's why we study the Bible. That's why we look to the Bible. We look to the Bible to see what is God's truth. And how does that work? Well, sometimes the Bible says things that really make us wonder, what did God want with that? And sometimes the Bible says things that make us say, oh, gee, now I understand. So as you grow older and you look at the Bible and you study it in Sunday school, and maybe you get to read it at home, you begin to see what God's truth is about. The main truth that it all boils down to, and we talked about this with the confirmation class today too, the main truth is all of God's word boils down to two major things. It's not always this simple. It sounds simple, but when you think about it, it's tough. And the two simple things are love God and love one another. That's it. That's our truth that we're to live by. Jesus' teachings, everything he taught, was about that. And so the truth that we find, God's truth, is a truth that says we're supposed to care about each other and we're supposed to listen to what God would have us do in our lives. That's important. And there's a whole lot more about God's truth for us to understand, too. I don't understand it all, as old as I am. And so don't ever feel bad if you don't understand it all either, because it's okay. But the important thing to remember is that God loves you, God needs you to love him, and God needs you to love one another and be kind to each other. That's God's truth, his major truth. You got it? Let's pray. God, I thank you for our children. I thank you for their being a part of our church and being here today. We're glad that they make the difference for us. They help us to be understanding who we are. They help us to be adults who care more about what we do when we look at our children and understand that they indeed bring something to the table that's very important. Watch over each one of our kids. May they be blessed by you. In the name of Christ, we pray. Amen. Thank you for coming up. Thank you, choir. Timothy was a young man who felt the call to preach, who felt the call to lead God's people. And so St. Paul became like his father in the faith. Paul adopted him as the young man that he wanted to help to do better. And so we have the book of Timothy. And from Timothy, we learn some new stuff that Paul wanted Timothy to know, and of course, us, from 1 Timothy 6, beginning the 6th verse through the 19th verse. Paul writes, "But godliness with contentment is great gain, for we brought nothing into the world, and we cannot take anything out of the world. But if we have food and clothing, with these we will be content. But those who desire to be rich fall into temptation, into a snare, into many senseless and harmful desires that plunge people into ruin and destruction. For the love of money is a root of all kinds of evil. It is through this craving that some have wandered away from the faith and pierced themselves with many pangs. But as for you, O man of God, flee these things. Pursue righteousness, godliness, faith, love, steadfastness, gentleness. Fight the good fight of the faith. Take hold of the eternal life to which you were called and about which you made the good confession in the presence of many witnesses. I charge you in the presence of God, who gives life to all things, and of Christ Jesus, who in his testimony before Pontius Pilate made the good confession, to keep the commandment unstained and free from reproach until the appearing of our Lord Jesus Christ, which he will display at the proper time. He who is the blessed and only sovereign, the King of kings and the Lord of lords, who alone has immortality, who dwells in unapproachable light, whom no one has ever seen or can see. To him be honor and eternal dominion. Amen. And as for the rich in this present age, charge them not to be haughty, not to set their hopes on the uncertainty of riches, but on God, who richly provides us with everything to enjoy. They are to do good, to be rich in good works, to be generous and ready to share, thus storing up treasure for themselves as a good foundation for the future, so that they may take hold of that which is truly life." May God's blessing be upon God's word for your ears. Express the mercy and the love of God as endless. God's wrath is slow, and God's love is eternal. And may that word speak to you and be close to you as we share it today in this place. What makes you happy? Think about that. What is it that makes you happy? Many, many years ago, a popular song lyric said that happiness is different things to different people. That's what happiness is. And it went on to talk about to this person and to that person what happiness is and all those kinds of things. Although, in effect, that may be true, that happiness is different things to different people, it does not well define true happiness, because at times what people have believed would make them happy, once achieved, only turns out making life miserable. For instance, many who play the lottery have the belief that if only they could hit it big, all the problems would be solved. Well, you know, when it gets big, everybody buys a lottery ticket. Lightning might strike. You never know. And many, many people who buy them think that everything's going to be over with. They won't have any troubles. Well, that didn't prove to be the case for one West Virginia man, however. You might remember his story. The man won over $300 million in the lottery. He already owned a $12 million business, and by the time he took the cash payout from the lottery, he had another $90 million. No problem, right? Sounds good. The money didn't solve all of his problems, though. He liked to party, he liked to drink, and he liked to play around. Everyone became his friend, and he was very generous toward all of them. Suddenly, all the women loved him, even though he was a married man, and he loved them back. A number of years later, it was reported in the newspaper that he had nearly spent all of the money he had won, that his wife had divorced him, he had no friends left who he could trust, and to make matters worse, his 17-year-old granddaughter, to whom he was leaving all that he had, if he would have had anything, died. He seemingly had it all, but in truth, he really had nothing, and he'd become a broken man. Rabbi Harold Kushner noted in his book called When All You Ever Wanted Is Not Enough, he said, "Our souls are not hungry for fame, comfort, wealth, or power. Those rewards create almost as many problems as they solve." He says, "Our souls are hungry for meaning, for the sense that we have figured out how to live so that our lives matter, so that the world will be at least a little bit different for our having passed through it." Isn't that really what we all want? You know, life is important in how we live life. And we want the world to be a little bit different because we were in it, in whatever little way we could make that happen. Well, when writing to Timothy, the young preacher, St. Paul, his father in the faith, told Timothy basically that what the world has to offer is shallow and unsatisfactory in and of itself. He wrote then that the best investment of our time and energy needs to be in the pursuit of righteousness, godliness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. We are, he said, to fight the good fight of the faith and never allow the world's obsession with money and fame and power rob us of our humanity. This morning, didn't make it in the sermon because I didn't see it till this morning. I was watching Charlie Rose's This Week on public television, and he had U2's a rock group, U2's guy Bono. Many of you know who I'm talking about. Some of you have never heard of him before. Okay, I understand that. But Bono has done so well. He's from Ireland, and he's done so well that he set up foundations and all that kind of stuff. And he does wondrous work in HIV virus with supporting, curing that kind of thing, and wondrous kinds of things for cancer research. This man has taken his rock music money that he's made, and he's done wonderful things with it. But he's being interviewed by Charlie Rose, and he sits there, and he says, Charlie talks about how talented he is, and he talks about how when he was a child, he was writing songs when he was a child, when he was shorter than the piano, when he reached up to touch the keys. He said, "I started writing songs when I was a child." And he said, "It's something to have." And Charlie said, "That's something to be that talented." He said, "Yes, it's something to have talent. But when you have talent, you also need to be humble. When you have a lot of things, you also need to learn humility." That's what he was saying. Fame can rob us. And you see that happening all the time to a lot of celebrities. Money can cause us a lot of problems, and you see that happening all the time to, like, the guy I reported about from West Virginia who spent all of his money. Paul told Timothy that the love of money is the root of all evil. If you love money more than you love anything else, you're slipping. You're in trouble. The money itself is not inherently evil. There's nothing wrong with having money. There's nothing wrong with having a lot of it. But if that's what your life is about, it's the love of money that is what is evil. If that's what your life is about, you're wasting your life. So then, why do people love money? People love money because it provides economic power that allows one to purchase more, have more, do more, whatever they want. However true that may be, money cannot make one become more of a person. And that is the truth. Money cannot make one become more of a person. As a result, it cannot buy true satisfaction, much as the unfortunate man in West Virginia now reports. Mick Jagger, who is arguably the grandfather of rock as he continues performing with the Rolling Stones well into his 70s. Can you imagine that? I can't believe my grandchildren are listening to Mick Jagger and the Rolling Stones. Can you imagine that? As old as that dude is? Ugly too. And he knows it. Kids listen to him. And so he's saying a number of years ago, decades ago, a lifetime ago, he's saying, I can't get no satisfaction. The Jaggerian philosophy, I can't get no satisfaction. Double negative, improper grammar, but for some reason it communicates. Life can indeed be a disappointment with unsatisfactory results if we place our trust, though, in the wrong stuff. If you're trusting the wrong stuff, you're not going to get good results. That's all there is to it. One time while window shopping, I stopped in front of a ladies' clothing store to look at and ponder a question that that store had written in its window. And often, you know, I like to shop for dresses for my wife. I like to do that. But my wives, yes, both of them now, have never really liked for me to shop for them, you know. My late wife, she was a size 2. So if you saw a size 2 in a rack, you buy it because it ain't going to be there anymore. It's just not going to happen. People buy those things because they're rare. So I'd see a dress I like, I'd take it home. I'd say, wear this. You're going to look great in this. And we'd argue about it for a little while, and she'd finally wear it, and then she'd go out, and you all would compliment her and tell her how good she looked. Thank you. Made my day. Well, I'm standing in front of a Talbots. It was a Talbots one time, and I was looking at it, and in the window it says, what is essential in your life? This is a store. Sells clothes. Nice clothes. Asking the question, what is essential in your life? Now, I'm sure it was the little black cocktail dress they were talking about or something like that. Maybe a new pair of shoes. But that really is both a philosophical and a theological question, let alone a very profound question as well. What is essential in your life? Corporate America, I've noticed, has grown to like using religious lingo in advertising. Ads will guarantee us that they're offering us new life, a fresh start, a meaning, fulfillment, even hope, if we use the products that they're pushing, if we buy their stuff. And we can be guaranteed that their stuff is going to bring that to us. You know, you buy the right kind of deodorant, you're going to be a better smelling person, so everybody's going to like you. They use those kinds of words in their advertising, religious type words, because the words are the language of conversion. Conversion. The logic is that if those words will convert people to the God of creation, whom we do not see, whom we cannot touch, whom we cannot literally look at, then they surely will convert people to the gods of consumerism, who are very seeable, very touchable, and give instant gratification. Nothing like a Tootsie Roll commercial. It gets my attention. Been a long time since I've eaten a Tootsie Roll. It's not good for my numbers. Diabetics don't want Tootsie Rolls. But boy, would I like to have one. There's one in my cabinet. It's been sitting there for like 2 years. Seriously. Instant gratification. The Jewish Talmud contains the question, who is wealthy? And the answer given back in the Talmud is, he who is content with what he has. That's the wealthy person. If he has much, if he has little, if he's content with his life, with whom he is, with what his life is about, that is the wealthy man. That is the wealthy woman. Rabbi Kushner, again, asks in his book, what is life about, he says. And then he responds, it's not about writing great books. Rabbi writes great books. He's written a whole bunch of them. I got them all. And he's making a lot of money off of them. He goes, it's not about amassing great wealth. It's not about achieving power. What do you suppose he says life is about? Rabbi Kushner says, it is about loving and being loved. That's what life is about. You can have all the power, the wealth, all the fame you want. As we can tell from some of the drug-addicted celebrities who've lost their lives with power, fame. I mean, we can go back into rock history and look at Janis Joplin, Jimi Hendrix, you know, our Purple Rain guy, Prince, Jackson. They had it all. So we thought. In Canadian folklore, there's a story told about how the western lands of Canada were settled by the farmers. They were giving the land away. You know, they'd push the Indians off. They said, let's go. You can get the land. You can have it to farm. And so the farmers were told that they could have as much land as they could run around from sunrise to sunset. So whatever land you ran around and got back to your original point, that land was yours. You marked it. It's yours. One farmer was determined that he was going to be the richest farmer in all of Canada, that he was going to have the largest farm of all. So he began to run in the morning. He ran as hard as he possibly could run. He ran. And just before sunset, he dropped dead from a heart attack. For him to have it all was a race to the grave. And the only plot of land he really ended up having was 4 feet wide by 8 feet long by 6 feet deep. Back in the 1800s, Henry David Thoreau, great philosopher, longing for a simpler, less complicated life, retreated to Walden Pond. Maybe you've read his books. There he built a one-room cabin. He then lived there for quite a while, and I think it was about 5 years he lived in this one-room cabin, kind of isolated, kind of almost like a hermit, thinking and writing and trying to understand life. And among the things he learned while doing that is, he wrote, if one advances confidently in the direction of his dreams and endeavors to live the life which he has imagined, he will meet with success unexpected in common hours. In other words, we today would say, if you dream it, you can achieve it. And life in America sort of proves that to be true. If you dream it, you can achieve it. I mean, let's face it, you know, I was talking to somebody yesterday about, you know, you remember Dick Tracy and his watch? They got it now. You know, those of you who go back even further, remember Flash Gordon and his rocket ships? Tell me what's different. Except it's not as corny, you know. But then Thoreau, after he said that, noted that at some point when we have advanced ourselves and we've accomplished what we've accomplished, he says at some point we, quote, pass an invisible boundary, beyond which we begin to establish new and more liberal laws and reinterpret the old ones in our own favor, living with license. And then he says, life then becomes very complicated and very inconsistent. You know, once we think we got it made, then we recreate our own world. And how that world will respond to us and how we want it to respond and what we want. What we want is important. Doesn't matter what anybody else wants. So he says, in proportion, when one simplifies his life, the laws of the universe will appear less complex, and solitude will not be solitude, nor poverty poverty, nor weakness weakness. He says, if you have built castles in the air, your work need not be lost. That is where they should be, your castles. They should be in the air. Now, he says, put foundations under them. Life needs a strong base to stand on, folks. St. Paul argued for us to have a more balanced view of life and of our material possessions, and that we should not see prosperity as some sort of evidence of our righteousness nor of God's favor. That's what people tend to want to say. I got a lot, I own a lot, I earned a lot, I made a lot, therefore God must love me more. I'm in God's favor. Cash is flowing, life is good. Paul told Timothy to commend those who are wealthy to not act haughty. That's the word, haughty. We had an aunt called Hottie. We called her Hottie. Her name was Nancy. We called her Hottie. It's because Hottie was like this. She owned an Uzi. You know what an Uzi is, don't you? Machine gun. She kept it in the house. Strange woman. But he cautions that we should not act haughty. Not be people who act in a way that is acting as if we're above everybody. But instead, Paul said to Timothy, do good. Teach people to do good. Be rich in works. Generous. Ready to share in order to take hold of the life that is really life. It's not money, it's not fame, it's not power. It's doing good, being rich in works and generous and ready to share to take hold of the life that is really life. Those, my friends, are the keys to happiness. You can only find contentment when you have decided to take hold of the life that is really life and you have decided to give yourself away. You can't buy it. Building your castles in the air, as Thoreau said, only makes life more miserable. It only makes life more unbalanced, lacking strong foundations. You can't buy it. No doubt people like Bill Gates and Warren Buffett, who are among the richest people on the planet, have learned in their lives the truth of what I just said. They are able to generate great wealth, but find their happiness, their real happiness, in giving it away, in order to serve the causes of humanity. Where I last served, the church I was at before I came here, there was a family represented in my church whose mom and dad got all the kids together. Now, this family was very wealthy. This family built the downtown YMCA in Detroit, paid for the whole thing. They had the largest yacht in the yacht club. And they got their family together, and they looked at their kids, and they said, we are going to put all of our wealth into a charitable trust foundation, and we're going to use our money long after we're gone to help things that need to be done. And we want you children to know that we're not leaving it to you. We're doing this because we would not want to rob you of the joy of earning your own living. I'm not going to be a trust baby. Those are the people that we pastors among each other called waiters. We called them waiters because they were waiting and waiting until mom and dad kicked the bucket. And we referred to them as waiters. No. It's like Martin Luther King once said, what self-centered men have torn down, other-centered men can build up. What self-centered men have torn down, other-centered men can build up. Being other-centered and not self-centered is when we accomplish balance, when you are other-centered, when you're not just focused on your own belly button, but you're focused on what it is that your life can really be about and what it is you can do to change the world and what it is that you can make happen around you in whatever way you're capable of doing that will make life for most people better. Being other-centered. And then we accomplish balance, we accomplish contentment, and we accomplish real happiness. When you invest that which you have accumulated within you, the wealth of the soul, the world around you is a world that it will be a world where you find happiness. The wealth that's within you, each one of you, in your soul, you have a wealth of all kinds of feelings, of all kinds of things that are going on inside of you that the world just needs from you. Love to flow. Joy, peace, knowledge, contentment. Everybody around you needs that from you. And it's in you. God put it in you. Every one of you, children, young people, adults, old people, you have it. But we tend to just hold on to it. Yes, happiness remains being different things to different people in our culture. You can tell that. That's why we have so many divergent attitudes and different ways of thinking about things, and we seem to have so many, you know, separations of ideas these days. Happiness is different things to different people if it's done the way the world views it. Yes, our culture today is filled with people who in Jagerian, I bet Mick Jagger would like that one. I coined that one myself. Jagerian phraseology will proclaim, "I can't get no satisfaction." Yes, our culture's full of that. That's why we have heroin addicts. That's why we have people who rob places. That's why we have people who are well off who act like they're the only ones in the world and nobody else deserves anything. That's why we have those problems, folks. It's about I can't get, what I can't get, what I want. I is the most important person in this country. Really? Yes, corporate America wants to convert you to a new life. They want to use religious language to convert you to a new life, to a fresh start, by getting you to buy their special product, making you think it'll make you a better person if you have that car, or if you have that particular kind of perfume, or you have that particular this or that particular that, or wear these shoes because they got a particular name on them. You can be a walking advertisement with a t-shirt. Make money for those people you bought the t-shirt from. St. Paul, however, told Timothy over 1,900 years ago, think about this, 1,900 years ago, he told Timothy, and subsequently all of us today, that today that happiness is found, not by the things we've just discussed, but when we decide, he said, to invest our lives in godliness, righteousness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. So if you want to be happy, then it's an attitude adjustment. It's a paradigm shift. It's seeing things in a different light. Take any one of those you want. They all mean the same thing. It's finding in your life and investing in your life godliness, righteousness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. And in those things is where we are able to find what St. Paul said is life that is real life. Those are his words. Life that is real life. And if you're not living that life that is real life, that's how to get it. It's not the bank account. It's not the fame. It's not the power. It's not whether you're elected president or not. It's not elected being elected to Congress. It's not whether somebody thinks you're all that ever was or ever shall be. It's becoming a person who exudes godliness, righteousness, faith, love, endurance, and gentleness. Think about that. Amen. Oh God, we pray that in our faith we would grow stronger. We pray that in our faith we would understand that there is no weakness, that there's actually strength in the faith of Jesus Christ. There are many people in the world who see us as weak people because we follow the Christ. But we are investing in the life that is real life. A life that isn't based upon what it is that the world has to offer, but is based upon what it is that you, God, guarantee to us. And so help us, each one, to grow stronger in that faith, to be more gentle, to be more loving, more caring people, to be people who see our call in life to be wealthy citizens of the kingdom of God, wealthy in soul and spirit, and able to be truly a witness to Jesus Christ. And so we pray that you would forgive us when we have faltered, that you would lead us where we must go, that you would reveal to us the truth that we must know, and that you help us to know you better in our lives as the children are studying in Sunday school. And we pray, God, that we would be true witnesses of the faith. In our prayers, we remember those whose names we've mentioned earlier before the service. We ask, God, that you'd be near them, watch over them, help them whatever way, whatever they face. We ask, God, that you'd be with those who are far away from us, who are wearing uniforms for our country and representing us. We pray for them, and we pray that they would be always well and safe. We pray for those countries that are at war right now, God, because the truth is, war never really determines who's right. War only determines who's left. Never determines who is right. War always determines only who is left. And so, God, help us not to be people who see that power is the only thing that needs to be exuded, needs to be placed out there, but the reality that we seek a peaceful way of living with each other and see each other as brothers and sisters, no matter whom we may be. Lord God, there are things that probably we will never accomplish in our lifetime, but we know this, that you are our Creator. Your Son Jesus died for our sins, and in faithfulness we reach out to you to serve you in the best way we are able to do. And you find that to be good. Help us, Lord. Help us in our weakness. Help us in our lack of hope. Help us in our lack of determination. And lead us in a way that shows that you are our God and we are your people. And we pray this prayer in Jesus' name, who taught us that we can pray together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our debts as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not to temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. You and I work together as partners in this faith, as partners in the custodianship of this church, the good stewardship of this church, the good stewardship of its staff, of its facilities, of its missions. And how we do that is we do that through our time that we give to the church, through our talents that we share, and through our money that is used to buy what's needed and take care of what's needed and accomplish those things. So when you give of whatever you give, it means something. It means a lot to God's work. God blesses us in so many ways. And so we just return to God much of those blessings, knowing that God will return to us even more. Even more. Be grateful as you give. Indeed, God, we are grateful that we are capable of giving. Whatever the gift, whether we think it's large or whether we think it's small, you receive it and you accept it and you bless it. And so, God, we bring you these gifts before you, these things that we want to use to glorify your name and make a difference in the world. Bless the hands that prepared these and brought them to this place. Bless the time and the talent that we also bring with our treasures so that your church prospers and your name is known throughout the earth. We pray in Jesus' name with gratitude in our hearts. Amen. You know, the world is working hard to go into trouble. And there's not a lot of good things that happen in many ways, but there are many, many more good things going on in many ways. So be part of the good things. You are people who call upon the name of Jesus Christ as your Savior, and you call yourself a Christian. And so go out and be that. If you go out and love and have compassion and are fair-minded and caring and generous, God's saying, you're really trying. And God sees that. So don't be afraid to be a Christian in a world that's going wrong. Be more aware of the need for you to be a Christian in the world that needs something right. So go out and serve God in all that you say and do. Be a blessing to others. Be faithful and faith-filled. And God will bless you by making his face to shine on you and by granting you peace.